Audiobook, Simply This Moment. Nijnjnana Meditation, 2. Fremantle's Endo. 21st of June 2000. From Diversity to Unity. Meditation is letting go of all that. We are letting go of the five senses by choosing just one part of one sense space, just the breath, or something else. After a while, everything disappears, until even the perception of the breath disappears. In other words, it is the happiness of just being with one simple little thing. Eventually that happiness becomes so strong that the mind becomes aware of the happiness of the breath disappearing. Once the body or the five senses disappear, in traditional Buddhism, in the way of my teachers, and in the way of experience, what happens next is that a beautiful light appears in the mind. In our tradition we call this a nimitta. This nimitta is no more than the sign of your mind when the other five senses disappear. The Buddha gave a very wonderful simile. He said it's the same as on a cloudy night when the clouds part and the disc of the full moon appears, bright, brilliant, and clear, in the sky. This is a simile of what happens when the five senses disappear. What you are seeing is a reflection of your own mind. I always tell meditators to understand that what you are seeing is not something through the eye, it is not a vision, this is a mental object. This is the mind being a beautiful mirror and seeing itself. And at this time in the meditation, when these beautiful lights appear, you have to be very still because it's like looking at your own face in the mirror. If you move, then so does the image in the mirror. If you try and hold the mirror still, it doesn't make any difference. You have to be still. The observer has to be so still, so motionless that what is being observed is also motionless. The degree of peacefulness is measured by the stillness one experiences in these states. The degree of inner energy is born of stillness, born of contentment, and is the measure of the happiness. The brilliance of what one experiences is the happiness, and that becomes quite immense at this stage, but it's not a happiness of the five senses. On the contrary, it's the happiness of the mind released from that world, it's happiness born of letting go. As an interesting aside, many of you may have heard of people who have had out-of-the-body experiences, people who have died temporarily and come back to tell the tale. Have you ever heard of people dying? First of all, they float out of their body. And then they seem to be going towards the light. What you experience when you die is no more than the five senses stopping and the mind manifesting itself. That mind being manifest is no more than the light that people see when they die. That's why this meditation is almost like training for dying and getting to know what it's like when the five senses stop and disappear. If you can manage to merge into the light, that is called jhana in Theravada Buddhism. It's called a jhana because it's a fullness of the meditation, a time when you've completely merged with the mind and the five senses are completely gone. In our tradition, it's the first real experience of non-duality. It's non-duality because there are not two anymore, there is no separate observer, the mind is unified. It is the first real experience of what they call samadhi. That centering or unification just on the one sense of mind. And it's very blissful. But it's not that one gains these states just for the sake of bliss, it's also for the sake of what these states mean. These aren't stages of attachment, they are stages of letting go. They arise because you've let go of a great burden. One of the disciples here in Perth, I like telling this story because it's a fascinating story, managed to get into one of these states of meditation. He just fluked it by chance. He was doing meditation in the bedroom of his house. After a couple of hours, his wife checked up on him because he usually only meditated for 45 minutes or an hour. When she went into the room, she saw her husband, a middle-aged Australian, sitting so still she couldn't even see his chest moving. She put a mirror under his nose and she could see no sign of breath, so she panicked and called the ambulance. The ambulance came from Sir Charles Gairdner Hospital and the medics stormed into the bedroom where he was sitting. Meditation. They took his pulse, there was no pulse at all. So they put him onto the stretcher and into the back of the ambulance and went screaming off with all the sirens going to the hospital. They got him into the emergency room and put all the machines on him and they could see from the machines that he had no heartbeat and no brain waves, he was brain dead. But the interesting thing is that the person who was looking after the emergency room that evening was an Indian doctor. He was an Australian, but his parents were from India, and he had heard his parents talking about people who go into deep meditation in India. When he heard that was what this man had been doing, he noticed a strange thing: the upper half of his body was still warm. Usually if someone is dead they would be cold all over. So he decided to give him electric shocks, to try and start his heart up again. They tried several times and nothing worked. Then the man came naturally out of his meditation, sat up, and asked, "How did I get here?" Afterwards he said he was just blissed out. But the worst part of the experience was walking home with his wife because she gave him a scolding and made him promise her that he would never do it again. That was a shame because it was a wonderful experience to have and it showed just what's possible with meditation. The happiness of that state should be understood. It is the happiness of letting go. Anyone who has experienced those states already knows what will happen when they die. When the body disappears, you are left with the mind. When you experience these states, you're beginning to understand the core of this thing that we call body and mind. You'll never have any doubts about rebirth, nor will you have any fears about death, if you understand the nature of the mind. But more than that, one understands that by letting go of doing, manipulating, and craving, you get these happy states. Many people have had these states once, just by chance, and have craved to get them back again. If you've had a religious experience, a state of bliss, and crave to get it back again, you never will. The only way to experience those states is by a very profound letting go, a very, very profound non-doing, and a very profound emptiness of the mind, a mind empty of the doer. All these things just happen by themselves. They are beautiful processes, empty of a controller, empty of a doer. That is what you are learning to let go of in this beautiful meditation. The more you control, the more you press the buttons and flick the switches, the more problems you get. It can be very scary to get into deep meditations. Do you know the reason why? It's because you have to disappear before you get into them. You're letting go of you, or what you take to be you. That's why it's wonderful to be able to completely get rid of the person in here who is always calling the shots, always talking, always making the decisions. Just allow things to stop by themselves. Once in our monastery in Thailand, there was a young novice who was listening to a talk by our teacher Ajahn Chah. Ajahn Chah would go on and on for many hours. "I promise I won't go on for much longer." He would go on and on and on, and this little novice was thinking, "When is he going to stop? When is he going to stop?" Hour after hour, this little novice kept on thinking, "When is Ajahn Chah going to stop?" And then the novice had what we call an insight. Instead of thinking, "When is Ajahn Chah going to stop?" he thought, "When will I stop?" And he stopped. When he came out of his meditation many hours later, the hall was empty. Ajahn Chah had gone to his hut and he was just sitting there happy and blissed out. He had stopped. Isn't it wonderful to stop? Every time we come up to a red traffic light, it's teaching us Buddhism. Stop. Do you know that in Delhi the traffic lights don't have STOP written on the red light? Instead they have RELAX. So when people come to a traffic light in Delhi instead of getting tight and tense, they see this beautiful word relax. That's what meditation is all about. In that, stopping is happiness. The more you stop, the more happiness you have, and this is the reason meditation gives you that inner joy, that inner happiness. By stopping, you energize the mind. You energize the body by exercising it, but you energize the mind by stopping it and calming it. Once you can get into very deep meditation, if you want to, you can even remember your past lives. All you need to do is ask yourself, what is your earliest memory? The mind that has a deep experience of stillness comes out of that stillness so clear, so powerful, and so well trained, that memories of your past come up very clearly, even memories of the time when you were born. Some people think that when you are born you've got no consciousness. I've been collecting stories of babies who speak. I have heard of two cases already in Perth. One of the cases was from two Australians, Westerners, who came to the monastery one day. They had two children, one was a 3-week-old baby and one was about 2.5 years old. One baby was named Peter and the other was called Richard. It was time for the elder boy Peter to go to bed and the mother and father sent him up to his room. Before he went to bed, he went to the prom, leaned over and said to his baby brother, "Good night, Richard." And little Richard said, "Good night, Peter." They were spooked, they couldn't believe what they had heard. They stopped reading their magazines and turned around in disbelief looking at the pram. The elder boy said once more, "Good night, Richard." And this time with both parents watching, fully mindful, little Richard, 3 weeks old, said, "Good night, Peter," and both the parents heard it very clearly. There are other cases like that. One case I've heard of was in Malaysia. It was in a newspaper article, so I don't know if it is true or not, but it deserves to be true. In a maternity ward in the United States, in front of the doctor, the midwife, and the nurses, when this little baby came out of the womb, it spoke in clear English, saying, "Oh no, not again." You were actually conscious at the time of your birth. And you can remember your past lives. What a wonderful thing to actually show that Buddhism is true and that meditation works. But please make sure that you don't come out again and say, "Oh no, not again." Please let go of this world. Conclusion. So, in our tradition, that's what we call the jhana meditations, and you can experience those jhana meditations deeply and powerfully. One of the things about jhana meditations is that you can't think, you can't hear, you are completely non-dual, one-pointed. There are many different jhanas, each of a different level, each level with more refined bliss. As you let go, not only are you knowing the nature of the mind, but you're letting go of that mind, and with full letting go everything disappears. That's what we mean by the bliss of Nibbana. Nibbana in our tradition is indicated by a flame going out. That was the usual word used when a candle or oil light flickered and completely went out. It was said the flame had Nibbana ed. Some of you ask, where is Nibbana? Where do you go after you get Nibbana ed? The answer is another question. Where does the flame go? Does it go to the north, the south, the east, or the west? The answer is no. The flame was always empty. It just depended on heat, the wick, and the wax. When those conditions end, so does the flame. And the conditions that keep you going, when they disappear, then so do you. Like a beautiful meteorite going around this solar system for thousands, millions, or billions of years, one day it finally reaches the end. It burns in a beautiful light which you see as a shooting star, and then it's gone. The beautiful light which you see as a shooting star is gone forever. It's just like a person roaming around Caesarea, life after life after life, until eventually they meet the Dhamma of the Buddha and go out in a beautiful blaze of light. They illuminate the Dhamma for so many people, and then they're gone. So many people, and then they're gone. So many people,